Bolivia is not a country that is accustomed to a lot of attention. It is, as many of you know, the poorest country in South America, and for a long time, people didn't know much about it outside of Bolivia. But now, it's receiving a lot more attention. Tonight is maybe evidence of that. Also evidence is that the latest James Bond film is actually set in Bolivia, although it's not filmed in Bolivia. If you happen to see it, you'll find that James Bond is saving the Bolivian people from the evils of global capitalism. So it's kind of a comedy of sorts. There's no mention of the social movements and the struggles that have really made Bolivia one of the most interesting places in the world for teaching us about what democratization means, what decolonization means, and what people can accomplish in today's globalized world. I can't think of anybody better than the folks we have tonight to help us understand that story. So I'd just briefly like to tell you a little bit about folks like Leny and Jim, who have really done so much to help Bolivian people organize themselves in such a strong social movement. Leny Olivera Rojas, who you'll meet more in just a bit, is from Cochabamba, and she studied information technology at the Universidad Mayor de San Simón. She's currently continuing her studies in sociology at the same university, and she's been a longtime activist in various social movements, especially in those involving the environment, natural resources, and cultural issues. She's currently the project coordinator at the Democracy Center. So please, let's give a welcome to Leny. She's accompanied by Jim Shultz, who is not from Bolivia, but he spent an awful lot of time there. Jim Shultz has degrees from Berkeley, University of California at Berkeley, and a master's in public policy from Harvard University, a small university somewhere in Massachusetts. He is a founder and executive director of the Democracy Center, has lived in Bolivia for over a decade, and has been incredibly important in accompanying and translating Bolivian struggles for a wide global audience. Folks who study Bolivia in the Andes know of Jim Shultz, of the Democracy Center, of Leny Olivera's work, and it's an extreme honor for us to have them with us tonight. So please join me in welcoming them both to the University of Washington.
Buenas noches, Seattle. Wow. I guess we can come to the conclusion that apathy has no home in Seattle. This is an amazing turnout. I just want to say that for both Leny and I, this event tonight, as this whole tour, is a really extraordinary experience emotionally because, you know, we write the blog, we write all this stuff, we write books, and this is the first time we've actually come up and run around the United States to see if anybody's been paying attention. And apparently, not just the officials at Bechtel read what we write. So, so thank you all for coming. Let me begin with some other thank yous. I can't say enough to Chris and Beth and the folks at Global Partnership for responding to our request out into the universe of who wants to have us on a book tour. They were interested, and this wouldn't have happened without them, and of course without the amazing support here at the university. The Latin American Studies Department, the Latin American Studies Student Association, the Comparative History of Ideas program in the Center for Global Studies, Tony, Christina, all of you, thank you for putting this together. Really, thank you. Well, my name is Jim Shultz, and I'm a gringo. I'm a recovering gringo. You never fully get over it. And I live in Cochabamba, which is an amazing place. How many people have been there? Ah, well, now we know why you're here. There are no saltanias after the event, sorry. Lo siento mucho. And it has been my honor for 10 years to live in Bolivia and to be a witness to these extraordinary struggles and victories, inspirational struggles and victories that have happened. I want to begin tonight's presentation to talk about two words. The first word I want to talk about is democracy. Some of you heard this last night, but I'm going to say it again. A very strange thing happened over the course of the last 8 years. I know this because I run an organization called the Democracy Center. And as I travel around the world, as we do with our work to the Balkans, to Latin America, to Africa, democracy, the word, has oddly become a dirty word. When I tell people I work with the Democracy Center, one of the first questions I'm asked is, oh, do you get your money from the U.S. government? Because people have come to believe that democracy means the system that the United States wants to impose, often at the barrel of Ock and Shaw, or Shock and Awe. That was interesting. Ock and Shaw sounds like a singing duet. That other one. And I find that really disturbing. We can't let the word democracy be taken away from us. It's an old word. It goes back to the Greeks and beyond. And at the Democracy Center, we believe that it is something more than elections, something more than shock and awe. Wanted to get that out straight. It is the inherent right of all people everywhere on this planet to understand the public issues that affect their lives and to have an influence and an impact on the public decisions that shape their destinies. That's what democracy is for us. And toward that aim, the Democracy Center engages in three kinds of work. We do training all over the world with people who want to learn how to be engaged in public policy. We lead campaigns like one that many of you know about with the Bechtel Corporation, where a global effort stopped the Bechtel Corporation from suing Bolivia for $50 million in the aftermath of the Cochabamba water revolt. And we write and investigate and publish. And the reason we do that is because it's the weapon for justice that we have at our disposal is knowledge, is information, is understanding, is comprehension. And the issue of globalization, the second word I want to talk about, it's a confused word. Now, in Seattle, some of you may have heard of this word. I hear there was something about it 10 years ago here. And it's become this Rorschach test, this ink blot. Some people hear that word and they immediately think, oh, a rising tide lifts all boats, economic opportunity, free trade, corporate opportunity. And other people see Darth Vader. You know, globalization, the evil one. And it's neither. Globalization began 20,000 years ago when a group of people in the southern tip of Africa sort of looked over the hill and said, I wonder what's going on over there, and started walking. And whether it's through trade or falling in love and having kids or travel or falling in love with Andean music, we integrate. The issue is, when we talk about economic globalization, what are the rules of the game? And who makes them? And for whose benefit? And Bolivia, for the last 20 years, has been the lab rat for an unfortunate experiment foisted on Bolivia by forces from abroad, the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, of what we call the Washington Consensus. It's the other Washington Consensus, not this one. I don't think you guys were in consensus, as I understand. And a strange thing happened in the midst of the experiment, which is the lab rat got off the table, unplugged the wires, looked at the scientists, and said, what part of no don't you understand? And so we set out in this book, Dignity and Defiance, to try to capture the stories of what this experiment in globalization was about and what the resistance to it has been about that has captured so much attention around the world. But not to do it in a policy wonk, analytic kind of way, but to tell the stories of the people 8 stories, from the Cochabamba water revolt to the story of hundreds of thousands of Bolivians who have left in an exodus for Arlington, Virginia, and Barcelona, Spain, and Buenos Aires, Argentina. So to center us and focus on what these stories are and give you a more direct sense of what this history in these last 20 years has been about, we have a 10-minute video that offers you some footage on each of these stories that we'd like to show you before we talk about them, Leny and I. I want to warn you, there are some images in this video that are disturbing, but we're here tonight to talk about reality, not fantasy. Talking about fantasy is what the Bush administration was about. So I bring you dignity and defiance. Can we have the lights?
Filiada a la Federación Nacional de Mujeres Bartolina Sisa, y somos nosotros las bases que tenemos que llevarle a esa mujer.
Nosotros no somos valoradas, no tenemos, no nos valora a nosotros nadie el trabajo de la mujer.
También seguimos luchando.
Que Bartolina Sisa ha luchado junto a su compañero, junto a su pueblo, junto a sus hijos. Eso es lo que hay que hacer, ¿no?
to put together these stories into a book that would have both depth and integrity, a team of more than a dozen people did some quite extraordinary things. Leny went into the jungles of the Chapari to interview the women who grow coca to understand their experience at the blunt end of the U.S. war on drugs. Barbara Gagnat, who was here at the University of Washington and came to us as a volunteer, spent months combing through data about water use and water prices to sort of figure out what the story was behind the water revolt from that dimension. An extraordinary young woman from Portland, Oregon, who showed up at my door. She was 25 years old. She just finished a 2-year stint in the Peace Corps. She said, "I got 6 months. Put me to work." And I said, "Well, you know, you see that stack of papers over there in the corner? It's about 1,500 pages of environmental and legal studies about an oil spill that Enron did here and got away with. And I haven't had time to read it." Her eyes lit up. And every day for months, I'd come into the office and these papers would be just spread out on the floor as she absorbed the information. Then we went to the marketplace, La Cancha, and bought an old bike. She put that bike on a bus and she spent 4 months riding around the Altiplano, talking her way into villages and homes and getting the testimony from people about what Enron had really done. Finally, at the end of this process, I had to walk up a mountain with my dog, sit under a tree, and figure out what the heck I was going to say about what I learned for a conclusion for the book. And on reflection, the most important lesson among many that I learned is the one I want to talk to you about tonight. And it's about the gap between theory and reality. There are people, maybe some people here, who believe that every morning the economists at the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund wake up, shave their face, or whatever the equivalent is for the women who work at the World Bank, look themselves in the mirror and say, "Now, what can I do today to screw the poor?" I'm not sure that's really who they are. I've met a number of these people at these institutions, and while the institutions, as institutions, certainly have a mission that's very clear to advance the economic interests of the United States and corporations from the United States, at work within these institutions is a belief that they really are advancing the interests of the poor, the impoverished, in Latin America and in Africa. And I have come to understand that they operate in a world of theory. They know, they may never have been to Bolivia, but in that cubicle in Washington, they understand everything there is to know about Bolivia. In fact, they know more about Bolivia than Bolivians. I live in Bolivia, and I don't claim to know any more about Bolivia than Bolivians, trust me. And it's because they read paper. They read reports. And it creates this sense that they know what's going on. And they turn that into not just advice, but coercion. And coercion with unbelievably damaging results. And I want to illustrate this by talking about the two chapters in the book that I wrote, because they're the chapters I know the most about. The first is the example of the Cochabamba water revolt. How many people are familiar with the Cochabamba water revolt? All right, well, that's pretty good. In 1997, the economists at the World Bank, in their infinite wisdom, came to the conclusion that the way to solve Bolivia's water problems was for it to privatize its public water systems, to hand control over to foreign corporations like Bechtel. Now, it's cool if they want to think that. It's great if they want to write papers about it. It's great if they want to suggest that to the government and to the Bolivian people. But that's not what they did. They told the Bolivian government in 1997, and while they denied this afterwards, it's an established documented fact in World Bank documents, they told the Bolivian government, "Thou shalt privatize the water system of Cochabamba and La Paz, or thou shalt not receive another dime to expand water services in the country of Bolivia." Now, the World Bank has some interesting mechanisms of coercion. One is to withhold aid. The other is that during the 1990s, when a lot of these decisions were being made about water, about gas, they said to the Bolivian government, you know, you need a higher class of public official. And they're going to need a higher class of compensation. And you don't have it. So you know what we're going to do? We're going to augment their salaries. So almost 300 public functionaries in Bolivia who were making these decisions on behalf of the Bolivian people were simultaneously receiving monthly bonuses as consultants to the World Bank and USAID and the International Monetary Fund. So you tell me who they were reporting to. So behind closed doors, the Bolivian government negotiated a deal to hand over control of the water system of Cochabamba for 40 years to a mysterious new company that no one had ever heard of called Aguas del Tunari, named after that beautiful mountain that overlooks El Valle de Cochabamba, La Yata. And they made fancy new water bills with their logo. And underneath their fancy new logo was a set of rate increases that range from 50 to 100% and more. I interviewed a woman named Tanya Paredes. She knits baby clothes for a living, and she showed me her bills, and she said, look, I make about $100 a month in a good month. My bill was $5, now it's $20. Where am I going to get $20 to pay for water? And that was enough to bring people en masse into the street. Now, Cochabamba is a city with a population almost the same as Seattle. So I want you to imagine a city the size of Seattle in which the collective will of the citizens of that city shut it down for a week. Three times. No cars, no schools, no offices. Imagine the collective willpower that it takes to do that. You saw the images. Victor Hugo Daza, 17-year-old, shot in the face. That was his brother that you saw reacting to it in the film. Some of you may have met his mother. She changes. Those of you who've been in Cochabamba, she's a money changer on Calle 25 de Mayo. What was the theory? The theory was that if you privatize the water, you get two great things that you need. One is skilled managers, and the second is foreign investment. It's a great theory. So who were these skilled managers? Now imagine that you are the manager of Bechtel's subsidiary in Cochabamba and you see those images, those precise images on television when you're sitting in the Hotel Portales watching it. And their reaction was to send faxes to the television stations to say, we're not leaving. That's who these great skilled managers were that came to Cochabamba. I cannot imagine the moral decision to respond in that way. And foreign investment, yeah, they cut a great deal. They guaranteed themselves, using the power of the bullet to enforce it, they guaranteed themselves a 16% rate of return on average every year for 40 years. If anybody knows where I can get a 16% rate of return every year for 40 years, I'll be around afterwards, and we can have a conversation. Theory versus reality. Theory versus reality. Second story, International Monetary Fund, 2003. International Monetary Fund's job is to have a look at the fiscal sustainability of governments around the world. And they looked at Bolivia and they said, you know, you got a problem. You got a budget deficit. It's big. It's almost $300 million. Budget deficit of the United States from the time I started talking until the time I end. Now, they could have gone down the street to the White House, it was only two blocks away, and made their case about budget deficits over there, but they made their case in Bolivia. But again, they didn't make their case. I said, you know, we're just looking at it, just want to let you know, FYI, I think it's a bad idea to have budget deficits. But that's not how they work. Because if the IMF says you're not doing the right thing, you are blacklisted. It means that you don't get IMF aid, it means you don't get World Bank aid, it means you don't get Inter-American Development Bank aid, it means you don't get bilateral assistance from the Europeans, Germany, Spain, Italy, the Dutch. You're blacklisted. And so the president of Bolivia freaked out, González Sánchez de Lozada, and he said to this group of young economists who work for him, find the money. Find me a way to cut the budget or raise taxes, but close the deficit. And they come back and they said, you should raise taxes on foreign oil companies, because that's where the money went. When you privatized it, you lost all that revenue. That's where you should get it back. And he said, no, 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 no. Can't do that. This is what his vice president told me, who later became president when I interviewed him, Carlos Mesa. The great alibi, the great argument of the multinational corporations is legal security. The moment that you change your tax rules, you are changing the rules of the game that establish the possibility that those companies will come and invest in Bolivia. With another set of rules that are less predictable, they say, we wouldn't have risked coming here. It's the same thing they say is if you're going to raise taxes in Seattle, everybody's going to move to Reno. And it is neither automatically correct or automatically incorrect. As anybody who took Economics 101 in college understands, it's a math equation. But the IMF, despite the fact that I think they have an abundance of calculators, never bothered to do the math equation because they applied an economic ideology. And the Bolivian government responded by saying, okay, we can't raise taxes on the foreign oil firms, so what we'll do is we'll have a new income tax all the way down to people who make $100 a month, policemen, nurses, teachers. They didn't like it. They didn't like it. How many people have been to Plaza Murillo in La Paz? Raise your hand. You know how it looks. It's like every other plaza in Latin America, right? You have the government building on one side, the cathedral on the other. Valentine's Day, 2003, 6 years ago next week. In come these high school students, and they start throwing rocks at the presidential palace. And out come the soldiers on the balcony with tear gas. And the students run over to the other side of the plaza where the police who oppose the tax increase are gathered. And they say, defend the people. You have a shooting war for a day on the steps of the National Palace between the police and the army. Now, that's not a great recipe for a stable investment environment. The bullet holes are still in the wall. 34 people were killed. And one of whom was a 24-year-old student nurse whose family I came to know during the course of writing this book, named Ana Colque. Through the panoramic windows of the International Monetary Fund's office in La Paz, you can see down to the rooftop where Ana Colque, a 24-year-old student nurse and single mother, was shot and killed in February 2003. When I interviewed her mother for this book, her 3-year-old son was asleep on the couch. Army sharpshooter sent a bullet through her chest when she climbed to the roof to come to the aid of a 25-year-old handyman who had also been shot and killed by the same sharpshooters just an hour before. Both of them died during a violent military assault intended to quell public protests against an economic belt tightening package imposed on Bolivia by that same International Monetary Fund. And this is my point. There is a connection between those offices on the 14th floor of the central bank and the roof of a building across from Plaza San Francisco where a woman lost her life and a son lost his mother. And we have to understand what that connection is. Why? Because these institutions are our institutions. They are institutions of this country. Who appoints the president of the World Bank? The President of the United States. What is the single country in the charter of the International Monetary Fund that is guaranteed a veto power over the major decisions of the International Monetary Fund? It's this country. Who are the companies? Bechtel, Enron, they are our companies. Who is the government behind the war on drugs? It's our government. Barack Obama said in his inaugural address on January 20th, look, there are people all over the world who want to blame the United States for things, and, you know, we have to, that's just not fair. Fair enough, a lot of people do blame the United States for things and aren't the United States' problem. But the fact is that these institutions are, our institutions are doing these things in the world, which leads me to the last word I want to talk about before I close, and that's the word oblivious. We cannot, as a people, afford to be oblivious. And not just because people will come and knock down our skyscrapers, with airplanes. But because if we want to be a moral nation in the world, we have to understand how these institutions that are accountable to us are acting in the world. I don't have to explain that to you. You're here. You're not part of the oblivious. But you have a mission. You have a mission to help this country become less oblivious. That's what we have to do in this world, is we have to help this country understand in a way that's reasonable and has integrity how it is that we impact the lives of people in other countries. That's why we wrote this book. I don't care whether you buy it, I don't care whether you steal it, I don't care whether you photocopy it, but I want you to read it, and I want you to get other people to read it. How many people here will commit to read this book by theft or honest means? Thank you very much, and let me pass word to one of the most extraordinary Bolivian activists that I've had an honor to work with, which is why I stole her and made her come to work at the Democracy Center, Leny Olivera. Thank you very much.
Good evening. My name is Leny Olivera. I come from Bolivia. And I will talk about the impact of globalization in my country, especially when theory and reality is totally different thing, like Jim was saying. And for that purpose, I will take two examples from the book, which are written in two chapters that has to do with the coca leaf and the oil spill in the highlands of Bolivia. And those two examples has to do with kind of an impact that sometimes we cannot measure, and it's more than numbers. And for me, that has to do with culture and environment. So I will start with the coca leaf. I assume that maybe here, not all the people think that coca is the same thing as cocaine. But I'm sure in most of the people in U.S. and not just in this country, but in many other parts of the world, many people think that coca is cocaine, which is not true. And I think it's because many people ignore what it represents in Bolivia. The coca leaf has been part of Andean culture for more than 4,000 years, and it has been used in very different ways, and we're still using it. It's a very important symbol in rituals and festivities among relationships, very important relationships. For example, I will just mention some examples of how we're still using it. In many indigenous communities, if a couple decides to get married, the man's family go to ask women's hand to ask because of that decision, and whenever they go, the first thing that they will invite them is are coca leaves. And if the family accepted, so they receive always in this way. So I'm sure the ones who went to Bolivia, someone invites you coca leaf, and we always receive this because it's something like very important for us. And in that way, it's used as a symbol of dialogue, good intentions, and many things. And we have other uses. For example, many students use it. Whenever I have to study, I chew coca leaf to not fall asleep or be more concentrated. And you cannot imagine the uses that we have with coca leaf. And it has a lot of nutritious values, and we use it also as a medicine. So it's incredible. But what happened is that after discovering all these benefits for health, the president of industrial pharmacy at the end of the 40s came to Bolivia to make a research for 3 months, which I think it's so short to make a very serious research. And what happened was that he declared that the coca leaf creates mental disorder, and that's why we had poverty. It was just for him, that was the reason why we were poor. And 10 years later, the United Nations penalized it. So right now, the coca leaf is considered as a drug. It's in the drug list. And we cannot export any product related with coca leaf, even coca tea. And that's, well, except Coca-Cola company, I'm sure many knows that if the Coca-Cola was made based on one of the 13 alkaloids that the coca leaf has. And right now, in the name of the war on drugs, the U.S. government is paying many police officers in Bolivia to put many innocent people in jail. And I would like to mention just one example of this. It's about a woman whose name is Lourdes, who's in the book. And this woman, nothing has to do with drug traffic, but he was in jail for 22 months with her baby. And I would like to read this part of an interview that Jim made when she was in jail. Lourdes and Marcos were locked in a 10 by 15 foot concrete cell with a dozen other women and their children and infants. I always accepted that I am poor, that I wear old clothes, she explained. I never choose to do anything illegal to change that. Never in my life did I think I would be there. So this is just one example of many cases. I think almost 50% or more of the people who is in jail is because of a law that U.S. government imposed us. So the worst thing for me is that she just represents a number for the U.S. government. It's just a number because the theory is that as much numbers of people we will have in jail, it means that the war on drugs is working and it's successful. And I think it's not working because we're still having this cycle of drug traffic. And another example that I would like to mention, it has to do with environment, and Jim already mentioned it. The Bolivian government during the 90s privatized most of our natural resources, and one of those were the oil. So the oil pipelines were given to Enron and Shell. And in 2000, Enron and Shell spilled 29,000 barrels of crude oil in highlands of Bolivia. And the worst thing was they spilled that oil in a very important river, which is the primary water resource of many indigenous communities around it. So what happened is that when indigenous people discovered this black thing in the river and in the land farm, so the people from the company make them believe that this was fertilizer. And the thing that was poisoning their animals and land farm supposedly was a fertilizer. And the worst thing is that they knew it was not an accident. They knew that they had to change this pipeline. The government told them and the workers that were working on that, but the company didn't change it, and that's what happened. And I would like to read also a part of interview. It's just a part of the book that shows the impact that these people, I'm sure, still living with that impact. And Jim mentioned that our friend Christina Hackland was there for me, an example of really, if you really want to understand a country or what happened with this disaster, for example, it's been there. Sometimes you cannot understand many things just being there and living in that place. So I would like to read this part. 6 years later, Doña Julia kissed the banana that I handed to her, my friend Christina, to this woman. She smiled wide and told me that she thinks her sheep are actually pigs. They never stop eating and never seem satisfied. They told us the petroleum was fertilizer, she said. Who, I asked, the oil spill people. So for me, there are many, as I was saying at the beginning, those kind of impacts are difficult to measure. They compensate a part of it, but there are many other things that's still happening. And to finish this, talking about this chapter, I will read also a part of a book. There will be no reimbursement for the livestock stillbirths yet to come, the deformed animals yet to be born, the reduced amount of milk yet to be produced, future health problems, or the painfully slow recuperation of grazing pastures along the river. And we had no idea that the worst was yet to come, that even after the black was gone, we would still be suffering because of it. So as you see, there are many, the impact in people's life, it's something that's very difficult to know. And we are used to understand many things, like Jim said, through papers, especially at the universities. But the thing for me, the conclusion of the book is just that we don't have to assume many things if we really don't understand. We have to be open, at least to listen or be there. And as many chapters shows how many people in Bolivia struggle against this impact, I think it's not enough, because really challenge globalization, I think we have to work together, because as you mentioned, many corporations, institutions like the World Bank, the FMI, and the US government, and many multinationals are in the United States. And I think we need to do another kind of intervention, and if people in the US could be involved in that, I think we could have a better impact. And that's why for me, to have big changes, we really need to be involved in this process. It's not enough to have a new government, even a new constitution like in my country. Of course, this is a very big step and it's important, but the main, for me, the most important thing is that we have to be there, involved in this process of change. Thank you.
To wrap up, we want to tell you what we want from you. This is an image from the Cochabamba water vault that captures what people in Bolivia are willing to do to fight for justice. This is David and Goliath. This is a woman with a sling. That's all she has, a sling, just like David. And Goliath is at the other end of the street. This is just a couple blocks from our office. And those are armed policemen with both tear gas and live rounds. Imagine the courage. This is David and Goliath. This is Tiananmen Square, Cochabamba style. And so the question, of course, is what do we need from you to support exactly this kind of courage? We need you to help lift up the voices of people in Latin America in the US policy debate. And old-fashioned organizing and new technology makes that possible. You know, we saw in the aftermath of the water vote what happened when people all over the world decided to clobber on Bechtel for 3 or 4 years while they tried to get $50 million out of Bolivia, and Riley Bechtel personally pulled the lawsuit because he decided it wasn't worth the public relations damage it was costing him. So instead of walking away with $50 million, he walked away with 2 Boliviano coins, 30 cents. Thank you. Thank you, the people who participated in that. People chained themselves in the lobby of Bechtel's headquarters in San Francisco. It was an amazing victory. So how do we repeat that? Give you an example. In late last year, in November, George W. Bush, do you remember him? His father was president. He decided in his infinite wisdom that he wanted to continue the diplomatic battle with Evo Morales by taking hostages. And so he decided to pull Bolivia off the list of countries that are part of an Andean trade pact with the United States. 20,000 jobs at stake. So we heard this, and we were kind of crazy, you know? So we sat around the office. We said, well, you know, why don't we go out and interview the people who might lose their jobs? So Leny took off. Other people on the center staff took off in jeeps and buses, went to weaving communities in the highlands, went to the textile factories of El Alto, and we said to the people whose jobs were on the line, how will this affect you? And then we put it up on YouTube and tied it to an electronic petition and told everybody on our mailing lists, watch the video, sign the petition, help us. And then I called up I found out that the Bush administration was required by law to have a hearing on this in Washington in November. And so I called up the Trade Department in Washington. I said, hi, I'm calling you from Bolivia. And, you know, this testimony, we want to have a video shown as testimony. And the guy said, no. No, we never shown a video as testimony. So, you know, why not? Why not? Why not? Made a list of all of his problems. And we then solved all of his problems until finally they agreed, for the first time to our knowledge, to admit the testimony of the actual people affected in the form of a video. And we want to show you we'll just show you the beginning of this. The actual video is on our website. You can see it. It's about 5 minutes, but we'll just show you the first little bit of it. It worked better in Washington.
Para nosotros el ATPDA es muy importante para cada trabajador, porque creemos que de eso depende nuestra fuente laboral, de eso depende nuestro salario, nuestro ingreso mensual, con la que podemos mantener a cada una de nuestras familias. Es por eso que nos preocupa bastante esto que se ha anunciado del presidente Bush de que está suspendiendo el ATPDA para Bolivia. Yo tengo mi familia, mi esposa y un hijo pequeño de 6 años, donde día a día trabajo para ellos. Bueno, les mantengo con ese trabajo que tengo de exportación. Y bueno, también quedarían afectados. Yo en la empresa trabajo 10 años.
Lights. So, to quote from a recent movie, we are here to recruit you. We need people all over this country to be willing to be the army that will carry the voices of the people affected by U.S. policy into the policy debate. We need you, when we call on you, to call on your congressperson, say, we're coming over to your office, we need 15 minutes, and we want to sit down in front of an internet terminal so we can show you something and talk to you about it. That's what we need help with. We need people who will carry the voices of the people affected into the policy debate. Because if we do that, then we are responding to the obliviousness, and we are being the other side of the coin of the World Bank and the IMF and the Bechtels and the Enrons. We're being the moral compass of this country as opposed to the people who have given us such a tarnished image, especially these last 8 years. So how many people are willing to participate in this? How many people are willing to be a part of that army that will carry the voices into the policy debate? Let's see a show of hands. More, more, more! What's that?
It's your country. Why aren't you doing it in your own country?
Hold that for the question. You hold that for the question period. Hold that for the question. We'll call on you first. So, sign up on the sign-up sheets for the Democracy Center in the back, and we will be in touch to recruit you to this. Thank you very much for your time and attention this evening, and without further ado, we'll turn it over to Tony for questions and answers.
Thank you, Jim and Leny. Those were excellent presentations, and I know you have a lot to ask. So I think in the interest of time, what we're going to do is maybe take a few questions and then allow our panelists to respond to them. So I think Jim's already called the first question. Ma'am, would you like to make
your question? Well, I'm just responding.
Leny and I agree. I'll take these, and then she can take the next round of questions. People want to focus on current events in Bolivia. First, I don't blame the United States for everything. I think the United States, as I said, is a double-edged coin. This woman, Christina Hagelin, who peddled around and sacrificed an enormous amount to do that, she's an American. She comes from Portland, Oregon. I think she represents absolutely the best spirit this country has. But it is a fact. It is a fact that institutions that are accountable to our government, that are named by our government, corporations that are of this country, did these things. They absolutely did these things. And I think that it is an obligation on the part of the rest of us to intervene and represent the best of the United States, because if we want this country to be loved and respected in the world, then those of us who represent the best of who we are need to take action and speak up so that the institutions of this country that represent not the best of who we are not the only representations of this country in the world. So that's my response, and I hope it's adequate. Sources of information, there's some great books recently on Bolivia. Some friends of ours, Linda Farthing and Ben Cole, published a book called Impasse Bolivia, which is a really nice history that you can get. There's some interesting blogs. I have a lot of respect for Ben Dangle's blog on Latin America, Upside Down World. You know, cruise the internet, there are sources out there. I'm speaking into the wilderness. Who asked that question? So, there you go. And frankly, I think some of the mainstream reporters do an okay job. I think Simone Romero at the New York Times is a fine reporter. I'm impressed by the work he puts into doing his stories, like the front cover, the front page story in Lithium the other day. IMF-aid, who asked that question? You know, it's interesting, the International Monetary Fund in Latin America has become a banker without clients. One country after another, Brazil, Argentina, Bolivia, Venezuela have all basically told the IMF, thank you, but no thanks. And it's understandable why. I mean, if you were an undergraduate at the University of Washington and you went to Citibank and asked for a student loan back when they were still loaning money instead of giving out bonuses, and they said, no problem, we'll give you $15,000 a year, this will be the rate of interest, but a couple of catches. First of all, we pick your major. And we want to check in about the socks you're wearing. We're not quite too keen on that. And you need a haircut. People don't want to do business with a banker that tells them what to do. And so the IMF is basically losing clients in Latin America. And that's probably a useful thing.
Jim didn't mention that the Democracy Center blog is also a great place for information. So there's a tremendous, you should start there. OK, let's get a few more questions. Yes, ma'am?
Well, it's a pleasure to find two people from Bolivia. And well, what I would say, of course, we're not saying that the bank's evil thing or trade. I think the problem is the rules of the game, because most of the time, it's like someone came to your house and because you have something that they are interested on, and you gave them, well, they took the biggest part of that cake, let's say, and we are little left with the fewest part of it, and when, so many people say, okay, we you are very rich in resources, and now with lithium, and that's wonderful, but sometimes it's una desgracia, because every time it's, in everybody's interested in that, but in the worst thing is that the people who live there are not don't get benefits of it. The example of Enron, these people who was their lands were contaminated, and they even used the gas, the oil that was going through those pipelines. So I think that's the thing, the rules of the game. And you cannot help anyone if you put your own rules or you think you have your own idea of what's best for the others. The idea of development or progress sometimes are two totally different with our reality, especially in Bolivia, with, where we have a lot of indigenous. So I think, and I agree that there's a lot, there's corruption, of course, also. And I think the challenge is that we have to work, and it has to be more social control. People need to be involved, because we would have the conclusion that other people with these rules continue working, because that's the only thing. So I think we have challenges in Bolivia, of course, and with these issues, and also here, I think this system is not working, not just in Bolivia, what's happening right now in the United States with the economical depression. And did I answer your question? Thank you.
Let me add a couple of things. First of all, a las amigas bolivianas. And this, I think, responds to the lithium question and also something about what corporations can do. So it's sort of a mix. As Tony mentioned, I studied at Harvard. And I spent a year there. And I think I learned more in a morning in Bolivia than I did in grad school when I fixed the stupid broken water pump at my house with a guy named Victor the plumber, who was half blind. And he spent the morning trying to teach me opera. It went right over my head. In the afternoon, he talked to me about Bolivian economics. And he said, ¿Sabes qué es el problema? He says, our country always, we have all these resources, and we always sell them off as raw material. And we never get in on the action of industrializing them. Well, it's economics 101, right? And that's the problem. So you have the example of Potosí, where, you know, this is a hill that bankrolled the Spanish Empire with silver for 200 years. So that's the theft model of development. Then you had the sell it off as raw materials model of development with gas. That didn't make the country a lot of money. And so now we have lithium. The Prius of the future depends on Bolivia. Think about that. Sounds like Star Trek, you know, the lithium crystals. And what does Bolivia want? Bolivia wants to get a piece of the real action, which means jobs, which means industrializing. And that's not going to be easy. But that's the objective, and it's a completely reasonable objective that's non-ideological. It's just common sense. And it's a challenge, because Bolivia has to build up the capacity to manage this, to do this. It's not going to be simple. What should corporations do? I mean, I think there is a rule. First of all, corporations cannot control the basic natural resources of a country. You can't give a foreign corporation control over water. You can contract with them to lay pipe, which is a different thing than giving them control. And I think that's the role of corporations. It's how do you make sure that the partnerships leave control and the opportunity for genuine profit making for the people in the hands of the government and the people of the country. And finally, on corruption, I mean, it is an equal opportunity problem for all political parties. It, you know, has its corruption problems. Goni had his corruption. It is endemic in the Bolivian system, and it's a genuine problem. And where does it come from? It comes from a country that has been starved for economic opportunities. So it's like, hey, if I'm a public functionary, you know, this may be the only chance I'll ever get in my life to get some money on the side, and so I'm going to overcharge for the water pump and you know, get a little extra commission. And how you get that out of the system is a mystery all over the world, other than starting with having a public commitment to stop it. It's a genuine problem. See, we've solved that problem in this country because we legalized it. Right? You just give contributions to political candidates, you give no-bid contracts to Halliburton, and it's not corruption, you see, because it's legal, which I suppose would be an option in Bolivia, but it hasn't worked well here.
All right, let's take... I think we have time for one more round of questions. So let's, those students out there, yeah, right there in the back.
First of all, I think what would be very helpful would be to share with anybody. I'm sure, for example, when I knew a person from the United States that wasn't in my country, the first time that I invite him, the coca leaves, that person was thinking that something was going on with him after that. And I said, okay, now what will happen? And it's incredible. At that time, I could realize that really people think that's the same as drug. So to make cocaine, you need just one of the first thing alkaloids that the coca leaf has, and mixed with many other chemical things, but that are not controlled. The problem with war on drugs is focus on to eliminate the coca leaves and nothing else. What happened about here with the addiction? How much money U.S. government is putting to that people who really need help? And just because the coca leaf comes from Bolivia, Peru, Colombia, you cannot imagine all the things that happened before and with the cocalero growers. They were violating many human rights and many things. So I think would be important to at least share this information with. There are many websites in English and Spanish and about the coca leaf. And well, we had a campaign before. The ideal thing that we wanted, it's a challenge for us, is to take it from the coca, from the drug list that UN, because UN penalized it. So imagine if we could industrialize the coca leaf, doing many other products which are good for health. We could need more coca leaves for those things instead of having those coca leaves for cocaine. And in medicine, of course, coca was discovered, anesthesia was discovered because of coca. So the industrial pharmacy uses cocaine also. So I think we will continue with this campaign. It's not easy, even if our president is a cocalero. And I think we really need something, but in a global way, because not enough just Bolivia decided. And to do that, I think we need, it's a long process. But if we start working with social civilians, with the society, I mean, that will be helpful. And if you're more interested, we can give you our contacts and contact you with people who is involved with everything that has to do with coca leaf. Thank you.
I'm for that. How to get involved? Where are you? There are two of you. Where are you? Stand up. All right, you can stay seated. Otherwise, nobody will ever ask me a question ever again. Number one, go there. Go there. It's not about your head. It's about your heart. And this is a country that has a great heart. Thanks. Go there and let your heart be affected. You know, I didn't go to Bolivia to be political. I went there as a newlywed with a backpack to work in an orphanage for a year with my wife, and who knew we were going to come home with a five-year-old? And, you know, let it make a connection to your heart. And then bear witness. Bear witness. See what's going on. See how we're connected to that part of the world. See how we affect people, and start to tell your friends. And the internet, my gosh, you can write to people now. It's easy. You know, you can write for your student newspaper. The School for International Training in Vermont sends a semester abroad students down every semester, and there's a couple of you in the room that have been to Cochabamba doing that. Look, they come down and they write what they've learned. They make videos about what they've learned. So go to the region, do it with an open heart and with your mouth closed and your ears open, which is something new for our culture sometimes, and communicate what you've learned. That's a start. I want to close with this. You know, in all of this, of the last 10 years of living there, I tried to figure out what is the essence of what makes these people so courageous. more courageous than people in other parts of the world. And I found that answer in an unusual place, in a conversation I had at the top of a windy hill in Cochabamba with a 15-year-old who had been one of the water warriors. I asked him how he became political, what made him engaged, and he says, I remember one day my mother sent me to the store to buy some bread that would cost us one boliviano, it's about 15 cents. But she told me that we had no money and to ask the store owner if we could pay later. I thought to myself, my mother works so hard and still we have to borrow one boliviano to buy bread. That was when I knew that something wasn't right. That is when I knew that something wasn't right. It is about believing in your own ability to understand and to believe that voice inside you that says, this isn't right, the emperor has no clothes, the empire has no clothes, and to take action in response to that. That's what we're asking of you. Thank you very much.